Good evening. We welcome everyone to St. James on this 24th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Following are the parish community announcements. We are in the process of starting a new media ministry at St. James. If you are interested in more information in becoming a part of this ministry, please contact Deacon David Klein in the parish offices. He can be reached Monday through Friday during business hours. St. James Seton students will have their school pictures taken this Monday, September 14th. The Growing in God's Grace annual renewal is next week. Parishioners should have received a mailing this past week, including forms for commitment weekend, as well as information about the online option for completing the renewal paperwork. Check this week's good news for more information. At St. James, we worship as a community of believers, and so as we begin this celebration, we invite you to stand and give a nod or wave to those people around you. Before we introduce our celebrant, we ask anyone carrying a cell phone to please turn it off at this time. Thank you. This evening, our celebrant is Father Zach Tucker, assisted by Deacon Steve Nelson. Our opening song is City of God.
Awake from your slumber, arise from your sleep.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
We bless you, we adore you, we
Let us pray. Look upon us, O God, creator and ruler of all things, and that we may feel the working of your mercy, grant that we may serve you with all our heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Sirach. Wrath and anger are hateful things, yet the sinner hugs them tight. The vengeful will suffer the Lord's vengeance, for he remembers their sins in detail. Forgive your neighbor's injustice. Then when you pray, your own sins will be forgiven. Could anyone nourish anger against another and expect healing from the Lord? Could anyone refuse mercy to another like himself? Can he seek pardon for his own sins? If one who is but flesh cherishes wrath, who will forgive his sins? Remember your last days. Set enmity aside. Remember death and decay and cease from sin. Think of the commandments. Hate not your neighbor. Remember the Most High's covenant and overlook faults. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger and rich in compassion. The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger and rich in compassion.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all my being, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger and rich in compassion.
He pardons all your iniquities, heals all your ills. He redeems your life from destruction, crowns you with kindness and compassion.
The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger and rich in compassion.
He will not always chide, nor does he keep his wrath forever. Not according to our sins does he deal with us, nor does he requite us according to our crimes.
The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so surpassing is his kindness toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he put our transgressions from us.
The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, none of our lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. The word of the Lord.
Approached Jesus and asked him, Lord, if my brother sins against me, how often must I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus answered, I say to you, not seven times, but 77 times. That is why the kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who decided to settle accounts with his servants. When he began the accounting, a debtor was brought before him who owed him a huge amount. Since he had no way of paying it back, his master ordered him to be sold along with his wife, his children, and all his property in payment of the debt. At that, the servant fell down, did him homage, and said, Be patient with me, and I will pay you back in full. Moved with compassion, the master of that servant let him go and forgave the loan. When that servant had left, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him a much smaller amount. He seized one of his fellow servants and started to choke him, demanding, Pay back what you owe. Falling to his knees, his fellow servant begged him, Be patient with me, and I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he had the fellow servant put in prison until he paid back the debt. Now, when his fellow servants heard what had happened, they were deeply disturbed and went to their master and reported the whole affair. His master summoned him and said to him, You wicked servant, I forgave you your entire debt because you begged me to. Should you not have had pity on your fellow servant as I had pity on you? Then in anger, his master handed him over to the torturers until he should pay back the whole debt. So will my heavenly Father do to you unless each of you forgives your brother with your heart.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As some of you may know, seminary is a lengthy process. It can take anywhere from 6 to 9 years, depending on a variety of circumstances for each individual man. I was gratefully on the shorter end, spending 6 years, 2014 to 2020, in seminary. About half that time, I was in some sort of homiletic formation, which is a fancy word for a type of class or practice focused on homily writing and preaching. Well, I called home one Sunday evening and explained this to my parents, and my mother said to me, "Have you used us in a homily?" I interpreted this to mean that my mother would be mortified if I told family stories in my homilies. So, that being said, this story is 100% not about anyone in my family. When I was learning to drive, someone much wiser and more learned than I told me that the best way to drive, to deal with other drivers on the road, was to talk to them and to indicate to them what you needed them to do. Now, there are a variety of methods for this, shall we say, instruction, from patient to decidedly less so. I must admit, I felt slightly convicted while going over the readings for this weekend, which we begin with Ben Sirah, the author of Sirach, very subtly telling us, "Wrath and anger are hateful things, yet the sinner hugs them tight." Now, whether you are perhaps prone to aggressively instructing those around you on I-80, or whether watching the news serves to raise your ire from time to time, the readings for today speak quite strongly on the themes of wrath and anger. It's important to note that anger in the Christian view can be a positive thing. There is righteous anger, which is most often triggered by witnessing injustice, suffering of innocent people, or the exploitation of the vulnerable. This is not the anger that Ben Sirah is writing, indeed warning us, the readers, about. He is rather putting a spotlight on the sinful side of anger, on a corrosive anger focused on exacting vengeance upon whatever or whoever might be the cause of that anger. On the other hand, the psalm we heard speaks of the Lord's relationship to us, and thus the way our relationship with those around us should also appear. The Lord is kind and merciful, slow to anger, and rich in compassion. Charity, mercy, compassion. These are the opposite of the vengeful anger that we are warned against in the first reading. The psalmist tells us, "Not according to our sins does he deal with us, nor does he requite us according to our crimes." We are, as Catholic Christians, supposed to love those as Christ loved us. So this must be a description that we strive toward. Might read something like, "Not according to the other's sin do I deal with them, nor do I requite," which means to take vengeance upon, "nor do I take vengeance upon them according to their sins against me." These past 4 weeks, we've been examining the four doors to God's grace: worship, spiritual growth, service, and treasure. The first two, worship and spiritual growth, will assist us individually to grow toward the psalmist's vision for love of neighbor, stemming from love of God. From that individual growth, becoming more closely conformed to Christ, we are drawn out of ourselves, to serve and to give to those around us, becoming missionaries of Christ's charity, mercy, and compassion. That isn't to say that we will always do this perfectly. In today's gospel, Peter poses a very reasonable question. How many times should I forgive someone who has hurt me? His own answer is actually quite a generous one, for he suggests that he forgive the other person 7 times. In the scriptures, 7 is a symbolic number. It means perfection or infinity. Jesus' response to Peter's question leaves no doubt. Not 7 times, but 77 times. That's a lot of infinity. Jesus then elaborates upon this response with a parable. The king is owed an enormous sum by one of his servants. In some translations, the sum is actually given to us, 10,000 talents. Roughly the equivalent of all the taxes collected by King Herod in the entire country over the course of a year. It's a ridiculously high amount of money. And the king proposes a punishment upon this debtor because he has no way of repaying that sum. But the man begs for mercy. Rather than giving him a payment plan with student loan level interest, the king forgives the entire debt. But rather than be inspired or converted by this great act of mercy, the servant instead takes vengeance upon another servant who owes him a far lesser amount. We're told the amount of roughly 100 denarii, payment for approximately 100 days' labor. Like we may be, his fellow servants are disturbed by this injustice and report it to the king, who asks him, "I forgave you your entire debt because you begged me to. Should you not have had pity upon your fellow servant as I had pity upon you?" Jesus asks us the same question. He pours out his mercy on us when we pray the Our Father, "Forgive us our trespasses." When we call to mind our sins at the beginning of the Mass, "I confess to Almighty God." And most clearly in the sacrament of confession, "Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned." This realization of the forgiveness of God poured out upon us is key to the living of the Christian life. God, before all others, loves each of us with a merciful, just, and forgiving love. This love is the source of the divine antidote for Ben Sira's vengeful anger, as well as the source for us to love and serve those whom we encounter in our daily lives.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins, that I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. Brothers and sisters, our Father in heaven is rich in compassion. With hope, let us bring our prayers before him.
For Pope Francis and all who lead and guide the Church, that they be endowed with the grace needed to carry out the mission of Jesus Christ, we pray to the Lord. For the success of the Growing in God's Grace campaign, that the people of our community will see this as an opportunity to extend our love and service, we pray to the Lord. For all those who are sick, especially those who are suffering from COVID-19, may they be granted renewed health and healing. We pray to the Lord. For the victims of abortion, for the closing of the abortion facility within our parish boundaries, and the conversion of heart of all involved in the destruction of human life, we pray to the Lord. For the souls of the faithful departed, especially Rick LaCarney and Bob McKay, and all those who have no one to pray for them, we pray to the Lord. For the repose of the soul of Bev Blaney, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord. For the prayer requests placed in our prayer baskets, and for the special intentions that we carry in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the petitions of your Church be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, so that we may receive from your mercy what we cannot ask out of confidence in our own merits. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look with favor on our supplications, O Lord, and in your kindness accept these, your servants' offerings, that what each has offered to the honor of your name may serve the salvation of all, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you, firstly, for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and George Lucas, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." in a similar way when supper was ended. He took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servant Bev, who has gone before us with the sign of faith and rests in the sleep of peace. Grant her, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Behold, Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Let us pray. May the working of this heavenly gift, O Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies, so that its effects and not our own desires may always prevail in us. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Do take a look at the good news this week, and a reminder that next week is Commitment Weekend. And take a look at that mailing that you've likely received as well. Hope will be available in the back, so feel free to stop by and see Mr. Jim Ely. And our Boy Scouts are here as well, so if you need any goodies, stop by and see them. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Join us in the closing song, Though the Mountains May Fall.
Over the mountains.